Alright, today is Tuesday, the 9th of August, and this is a recap for the stock market activities today. And folks, I got a good one for you tonight, but we have an important day tomorrow, CPI Day, aka CPLI Day, so let's not waste a lot of time, and here it is, in focus tonight. The calm before the storm. A lot of things will change based upon the CPI reading tomorrow. Now, let's do this. You know, the Fed, since last year, all the way till maybe the last reading of the CPI, they've been saying, you know what, we have to concentrate on core CPI because the headline CPI includes food and energy prices, and that's too volatile, and it might misrepresent the true nature of inflation because food and energy prices are tied to commodities prices, and those have been spiking higher, at least until recently. But we gotta look at the real core inflation in the economy, besides the non-essential things such as food, gas, oxygen, because you people don't care about that, right? And here in this channel, we criticized the Fed, and we said that they're playing games with the data. They should be looking at headline inflation because the consumer cares about gas and food prices. But okay, since the Fed wants to play that game, let's play the game. Now that commodities prices are down, let's look at core CPI, Mr. Powell. You like that? You see, all of that manipulation of the data is now coming back to bite you right in the ass. So here's what I want you to do. As you can see, these are the CPI components, but since the Federal Reserve told us not to worry about food and gasoline prices because the volatility in commodity prices. Okay, let's do that. Let's play the game. But we're just going to concentrate on core CPI. So we got what here? We got household furnishing and supplies, apparel, new vehicles, used vehicles, motor vehicle parts and equipments, medical care commodities, recreation commodities, education and communication commodities, services, shelter, medical care services, transportation, and recreation services. So you let me know in the comments. You don't have to answer for each category if you're not sure. But which category you think it's going to go higher, specifically month over month, and which categories will go down month over month? Because that's what's really important in this reading. We know that food and energy prices are down month over month big time. Now what about the core? Is the core CPI about to be sticky, and that means the Fed will have to be more aggressive in tightening the monetary policy? Or not? I can tell you from the recent data that we got, for example, apparel, I believe that will go down because we got Walmart warning that they have excess inventory in apparel. The demand went down suddenly, disappeared out of the picture, so they have to price all of these items down. So I can say maybe apparel is down, but what about the rest? Used cars, transportation services, ticket prices, and most importantly, shelter. You see, the conversation is going to shift when we talk about inflation from gas prices at the pump to rent prices. That's the big one. But before I start in looking into these categories, let's hear the good news first. Good news meaning inflation is moving down, meaning the CPI will come out as a massive surprise to the downside, and hence the stock market will have the biggest orgasm you've ever seen in your life. This is, of course, what the bulls are hoping for. What supports inflation going down? Look, for example, at metals prices. These are down big, specifically in the month of July. Likewise, agricultural commodities are down big. When we talk about wheat, corn, they're all down. We will look at the ETF, the Bloomberg Agricultural Spot Index. It is down big since the peak. Likewise, when we look at the commodities research, this is according to the Bureau. The spot raw industrials, that's down big since the peak. What is sticking right now is energy, be it is down from the peak earlier in March, and certainly down from the levels that we've seen back in June. So that supports a lower CPI. What else? Today, we also got data from Adobe, and it indicates that online prices are actually down for the first time in over a year. So that's good. What else? Today we got the small business index, and as you can see here, the index is abysmal still. But most importantly, according to the survey, the plans for higher compensation and higher prices went down. But that also came hand in hand with a slip in CapEx, meaning we're seeing prices going down in small businesses, be it due to the wrong reasons. Spending less by these businesses. They're not going to increase their CapEx because perhaps they see the economy slowing down, hence the recession theory. Okay, so we got new information that supports maybe the CPI will be down big, at least the headline. But what about certain elements in the core CPI, specifically those with major weighting? We're talking about used cars, new cars. We're talking about shelter, most importantly. And the inflation story right now will revolve around rent inflation. Rents are out of control in certain cities. Forget about the fugazi data that you get from the CPI. In certain cities, we're seeing rents increasing by 100%, if not even more. Now, I talked about rent inflation in details in a previous video. You can watch it. And of course, the landlords got upset with me. What are you talking about, Maverick? We have a lot of expenses. Of course, we have to raise rents all over the place. Why? I get it. It's inflation. It's capitalism. You got to take a shot and increase rents and benefit from this inflation too. But at least be honest and just say that. Stop playing poverty, like saying, oh, but we got mortgages that we have to pay. You mean the fixed mortgage that you're paying? Oh, but we got bills to pay. We pay for all of these utilities. No. The tenant is paying for these utilities. But Maverick, what about the prices of carpet? Yeah, you haven't changed the carpet in 10 years, baby. What are you talking about? See, landlords always play poverty. When you ask them to spend a few $100 to maintain the property or even fix something, they play poverty. Oh, but this is expensive. I don't have the money. Yada, yada, yada. But somehow they always find the money when it comes to filing eviction lawsuits. They pay these lawyers thousands of dollars, no problem. But when it comes to fixing something that worth a few $100, let's cry poverty. Okay, now, to be fair, a lot of tenants are abusive who destroy property. I got no sympathy for those at all. Likewise, when you sign a contract and you agree that you're going to pay X amount per month, you got to fulfill your obligations as a tenant. Pay on time. If you can't pay on time, we got a problem. You can't just stay at the place if you're not paying. I don't support these eviction moratoriums and all that crap. But I have no sympathy for the landlords either because they've been abusing their power. When you go to courts, for example, and I go to courts a lot, I know a lot of lawyers, and what they say is, you have these landlords with long-term tenants, and now that we have inflation, they can't really increase rent on these long-term tenants because they're under rent control, for the most part, at least in the state of California. So what they do is they use trickeries and loopholes to evict the tenant by saying, oh, we have to evict you because my daughter wants the place. I gotta move a family member in. And of course, most tenants, they get scared, they self-evict, they don't know their rights, and they get out. And then the landlord rents the property to a new tenant at inflationary prices. Because when you have a new tenant, you can charge market price. You're not limited by rent control. And that contributes to more and more inflation. And therefore, we're seeing more and more evictions and more homelessness. I got a problem with landlords in general because you get somebody who's a trust fund baby, grandma dies, leaves $9 million to the kid, he goes on, buys a bunch of single family homes, turns them into Airbnbs and rental properties. But what do? You sit in your ass all day long and you collect rent by the end of the month. You're being a pimp. You're not really producing anything to the economy. And this insane surge in rents across the country, it's going to cause the economy to stagnate because you have consumers spending 50, 60, 70% of their incomes on rents. They got nothing left to stimulate the economy with. And this is going to be a major, major problem. And it's going to backfire on the landlords. I'm warning you right now. It's going to backfire because the Biden administration will look around and say, look, gas prices are down. Yet people are upset. The polls say that people are upset about inflation, even though gas prices are down. Why? Because they're paying an arm and a leg on rents. That's going to be the new target for the Biden administration. But what they're going to do is, if it gets really bad, and we see lots of evictions, lots of homelessness, and rent inflation is not going down, what they're going to do is they're going to impose a nationwide rent control or a nationwide eviction moratorium. So landlords, you better be careful here not to get too greedy. And of course, the mom and pops, that's a different story. It's really the corporate landlords who scoop a bunch of single family homes and then they increase prices like crazy. Well, guess what? Karma is a bitch. Either the Biden administration is going to crack your little head by imposing rent control or eviction moratoriums, or the Fed will have to increase interest rates aggressively all the way till it crashes the economy and the housing market. And then your tenants lose their jobs, they cannot pay rent anymore, and either you're going to have the eviction moratorium, you can't even get them out anymore. Or, even if you get new tenants, you can't charge insane prices because the inflation is now dead. We have a recession. Yet you're stuck paying that mortgage because you bought the home in 2021 at inflationary prices. You better start thinking now. But at the end of the day, folks, the damage is already done. Rents are absolutely insane, and you're going to see that exactly in tomorrow's reading the CPI. And by the way, besides rents, what about the housing market? That's another horror show because look at this. Home prices are exploding higher. They're not going down. The CPI happens to be a lagging indicator when it comes to shelter inflation. And yes, maybe home prices rolled over from May, June, July, but that's going to take time to show up in the CPI. This upcoming reading in the CPI will show us rent inflation from December of last year, January of this year, and these numbers are really, really hot. So the risk that we have right now is a lower headline reading in the CPI, but a higher reading on the core CPI. Another item that is a source of concern that could push the core CPI higher, or at least sticky, is car prices. When we look at new cars prices, for example, we got the warning today from Ford. You know, the EV lunacy, they told us that if we go all in manufacturing EVs and dismissing regular cars, shutting down the assembly lines for combustion engines and scrapping hybrid vehicles altogether, just go all in EVs, the economies of scale will make the prices more affordable to the consumer. Are we going to save the planet? Well, neither of these things are happening. The prices are insane, out of whack, and we're not saving the planet at all. Today, Ford came out and said that the new F-150 Lightning, this is the EV pickup truck, they're going to increase prices on those because of significant material cost increases, quote unquote. And the high end on the F-150 Lightning, the MSRP is about $97,000. You think the Gardner is going to be able to afford this? The lower end model starts at around $46,000. That's too much to begin with, let alone $97,000. This is absolute lunacy and will continue to keep the used cars market hot, hot, hot. And you might say, but Maverick, what about the Inflation Reduction Act? They're going to pass tax credits if you want to buy an EV. Well, here's the problem. With the prices being too high for EVs, a lot of these EVs, matter of fact, the majority of them will not qualify for the tax credits by the so-called Inflation Reduction Act. Now, you might qualify for tax credits according to the Inflation Reduction Act if you buy an EV from Fisher Price to your six-year-old, but if you want to buy an actual EV, probably you're not going to qualify for that. And again, the used cars market is hot, hot, hot. And a lot of people are now feeling regret that they paid over the MSRP for a used car. Wow! You thought it's a genius idea to pay for a used car more than it was worth when it was new? Wow, who would have thought that would be a bad idea? But to be fair, a lot of folks had no other choice. They needed a vehicle and they had to pay above the sticker price for a used car, mind you. And are these used vehicle prices going down at all? The answer is nope, not even close. Last month, Cox Automotive Research uncovered a brace of unpleasant findings for car buyers. The average transaction price for a new car hit $48,000. That figure was ridiculous, $895 more than the month before, and an even more ridiculous 12.7% more than in June 2021. And buyers were on average paying $1,000 over MSRP for the first half of this year. So you might say, okay, let me get a used vehicle then. That's even worse. You know why? Because it's not just the lack of availability of new vehicles causing more demand for used vehicles, but it's also due to the car flipping phenomenon. Yep.
I'm sure you've heard of house flipping. Well, there's a new trend that's driving car owners looking to make some extra cash. CBS's Carter Evans takes a look at car flipping.
The rules of the road are changing.
How much did you pay for that out the door with taxes?
I think like $87,600.
Dennis Wang just bought a brand new Tesla 5 months ago, but the offer he just got from a dealer is too good to pass up.
And they gave you how much?
$101,000. It's absolutely insane. Mind blown.
The dealer paid off the rest of his loan, and Wang walked away with a check for almost $17,000.
In the last 2 years, I've been driving brand new cars and have not lost a cent.
Eddie Gribbist flipped his car for $5,000 more than he paid for it.
9 months, and this is how much it appreciated.
Even basic vehicles like a Honda Civic or a Toyota Camry, these vehicles are worth more in the used market than they are in the new market.
Typically, cars lose more than 20% of their value that first year on the road. Since the pandemic began, used car prices are actually up 53%, and that has some car owners seeing green.
We don't have enough new cars. Guess what? Consumers resort to used cars, essentially raising the ceiling for used cars cost.
What does this do for a mom who's going to try and buy a used Toyota Camry?
You know, it's going to be shock and awe. Now you're virtually guaranteed at every price point to pay more and get less.
But some car makers are beginning to crack down. GM is now warning buyers the warranties on some of its most popular vehicles will disappear if those cars are flipped within the first 12 months. Tesla says it may unilaterally cancel any order we believe was made with a view toward resale. And that's exactly what happened to Dennis Wang's next car.
My orders for Teslas actually has been deleted. So they're really just trying to protect the customers and, of course, themselves at the end of the day.
So this is what's going on in the economy, folks. Predatory behavior. Folks who got the money, trust fund babies, crypto gains, who cares? They go all in, scooping single-family homes, scooping new cars when they come out, They either rent them or flip them for a higher price, and this kind of practice supports higher and higher inflation. Folks, this is not going to stop. I'm sorry, but this inflation is not going to stop until we see real damage in the economy. What is real damage? The answer is higher unemployment, big time. We're not talking about 4%, 4.5%. We're talking about 6% plus. And then you will see the flipping phenomenon going out of the window. Corporate landlords scooping single family homes. They're not going to do that anymore because the demand will disappear when we have higher unemployment and a recession in the economy. Unfortunately, at this point, recession is the cure that we need to solve inflation. Whether you like it or not, it's the Fed's fault. If they increased interest rates last year, we wouldn't even be talking about this right now. But we're here, and that's that. Another piece of data that we got today supporting higher inflation is the unit labor cost, indicating higher wage inflation. Take a look.
Unit labor costs soaring 10.8%. 10.8%. The good news here is it hasn't soared past our December of 2020 when it was 13.8. That was the highest since the year 2000.
And while unit labor cost is increasing, productivity, on the other hand, completely collapsed. The worst drop in history. So there you go. This is the booming economy, right? But the main question is, hey, Maverick, I don't understand what you're talking about. You're talking about CPI, CPI, rents, cars, unit labor cost. What is this all about? Just tell me if stocks are going to go up or down. Should we go all in buying calls or puts? Well, for that, let's go to a segment we call Word on the Street. We start with the folks at TS Lombard. And they say the stock market has misread signals from the Fed and a pivot on rate hikes is still far from happening, meaning stocks will go down after the CPI. Goldman Sachs says it is too soon for the markets to be trading a full Fed pivot. And I shared with you before, the market is now pricing 3 interest rate cuts. Cuts, not hikes. Absolute lunacy. And then we got BlackRock, who warned that investors should be buying defensive stocks and bonds because the tech rally will frizzle. So BlackRock says, so far tech, the oversold tech, the high risk, high beta, high multiples, the mania names have been leading the rally since June. But maybe the CPI will change all of that and we see dumping of these recent winners and buying the dip of the recent losers or laggards. The utilities, the REITs, maybe some of the inflationary names in oil and materials. We'll see. But if you say, hey, this is too bearish, Maverick, I don't like this. I think the CPI will come out too low, and higher we go. Meme stocks to the moon. Well, you got the folks, the perma pumpers at JP Morgan supporting you. JP Morgan says that the stock market is about to kick off a sustained rally into the end of the year. There we go, to the moon. And with that, folks, let's move on to cover the stock market information for you. Now begin with the closing of the indices today, and here we go. The Dow Industrial Average was down by 58.13 points, or a decline of 0.18%. The Nasdaq down by 150.53 points, or a decline of 1.19%. The S&P 500 also down by 17.59 points, or a decline of 0.42%. The sector's performances once again on top, capturing the gold medal, energy, the number two for the silver, utilities, and here it is, number three for the bronze, REITs. Meanwhile, the laggards of the day, led by cyclicals, technology, and communication services. What about the advanced? The decline ratios, abysmal, bad breadth, so far in the market, at least Monday and Tuesday. The NYSE, 36% advancing versus 58% declining. The Nasdaq, 26% advancing versus 67% declining. What about commodities? Muted action for crude oil. WTI, Brent, both pretty much in the flat line. Nothing happened today. The calm before the storm. Yet on the other hand, we have gains for gasoline, the RBOB, getting closer to $3 once again. It scored gains of about 3% today alone. And then we have heating oil rebounding and gaining about 5% today. A natural gas, the party boy, celebrating once again with gains of about 3.25%. What about softs? Muted action for cocoa, OJ, coffee, sugar, pretty much in the flat line. Modest gains for cocoa and coffee of about 0.5 percentage point. But leading the gains for the day, a massive rebound for lumber, worth about 6%. And then we have cotton futures also adding to the rebound gains today with about 3.5%. When it comes to metals, muted across the board, waiting and waiting for the next move from the US dollar. And then we have meats down across the board, modest gains for live and lean hogs futures of about 0.5 percentage point or so. Yet we have notable declines for feeder cattle futures, down by about 1.5%. On the other hand, grains, we got few laggards here, led by oats, down about 3.25%. 6% today, and rough rice was down by about 1%. Muted action for soybean oil and wheat futures, but sizable gains across the board, led by soybeans, soybean meal, corn, and canola. Moving on to the big casino, the options market, what's going on here? The hottest stable by far remains Tesla, with about 1.2 million contracts traded today. About 49% of those were calls. Notice how the put-to-call ratio suddenly changed in favor of puts. They were buying 60-70% worth of calls. Not anymore. The sentiment is changing. And the options market usually, not always, but usually, is a leading indicator to the action that we're about to see in the stock market. But here it is, and number two, Apple, with around 900,000 contracts traded today. Look at this. Only 43% of those were calls. At number three, Ford Motor, with about 850,000 contracts, about 76% of those were calls. AMC, the volume went down, and hence the gamma squeeze appears to be frizzling for now. If the apes don't step up and start buying calls, it's over. It's just a pump and dump. Moving on to the unusual activities that took place in the options market today. We start with the ticker SPY. Now, pay attention here. A lot of you say, hey, Maverick, how do you know if this is a buy or a sell? Usually, who is the seller of options? The answer is the market maker. Us guys are not writing millions of dollars worth of calls or puts. It's the market maker. The market maker is not going to write random calls and puts out of the blue. Something has to trigger the selling, and that is somebody buying these options. And therefore, usually, we look at it from the buyer's perspective. For example, when we look at the trade for the SPY, somebody bought the 436 calls, but somebody sold these calls. The buyers believes that the SPY will go higher due to the CPI, or whatever catalyst, doesn't matter. On the other hand, the seller believes that the rally in the SPY will stop, so they're going to catch the premium from selling these calls. In this case, if we look at it from the buyer's perspective, somebody bought the 436 calls with expiration date September 2nd, with expectations that the SPY could pop higher and gain more than 6% by then. They paid around 75 cents apiece to enter this trade, all in all spending around $2 million. And then we have a put spread in the SPY. Somebody bought the 355 puts. They sold the 330 all for the expiration date September 23rd. With expectations, the SPY could move down and lose more than 14% of its value, but not more than 20%. They paid around $1.55 apiece for the 355 puts, and they received about 65 cents apiece from selling the 330 puts. All in all, the entry cost is reduced to about 90 cents apiece, and the total for the trade comes out at $900,000. And then we have the trade for the ticker SQQQs. This is the inverse index for the Qs. Somebody is bidding against the NASDAQ. In this case, they bought the 41.5 calls on the inverse index of the NASDAQ with the expiration date of August 12th, meaning this upcoming Friday. Somebody's betting that the CPI will upset the NASDAQ, and therefore they bought this trade. It cost them about 65 cents apiece to enter this trade. All in all, they spent about $600,000. And lastly, at the bottom of the table, what about the ticker RBLX, Roblox? I did buy puts in the name yesterday in anticipation of earnings. I bought the $40 puts for next week's expiration, and I paid around 80 cents apiece for those. Last time I checked, Roblox is down by about 17% after the bell. And honestly, folks, the name ran too high, too fast, ahead of earnings, a recipe for disaster. Because when you have a name like Roblox up about 90% since the June bottom, that raises the bar for earnings a lot higher. So even if the company comes out with decent earnings, you might see an upset reaction in the stock. Because those who scored 90% gains, 80% gains, 50% gains, they start to book their gains right away after the bell. Well, the earnings report came out abysmal, to say the least, and therefore Roblox is down big. My assumption is it will continue to go down all the way till next week, even beyond. I'm going to talk about this trade in the charts analysis because it's not done yet. I might make it into a calendar spread, a put spread for next week, we'll see. But for this trade, somebody bet against Roblox in the short run that earnings will disappoint the stock. And they bought the 43.5 puts for the expiration date this upcoming Friday, August 12th, with expectations that Roblox will go down by more than 8% by then. It's down by more than that, over 17%. So this trade is a winner, and they paid around $2.5 apiece to enter this trade, all in all, spending around $1.75 million. Moving on to the heat map analysis, what's going on here? We're seeing the same theme from yesterday. Getting out of the risk-on segments, chips, software, the cyclicals, communication services, the recent winners. They're booking gains and profits from those, and they're going back to buying the dip and wear in the defensives, utilities, REITs, the consumer staples, the year-to-date winners. And among those, of course, the defense contractors Lockheed, Northrop, all in the green today. The big pharma names also in the green. And we also see the inflationary trade catching a bit. We're talking about energy, we're talking about materials, the inflationary fertilizer names all catching a bit today. So you have the rotation of the rotation. In June, July, we got the rotation out of energy, the inflationary trade out of defensives, all the way back to technology and the risk-on. Now we're seeing the opposite because we have the calm before the storm. After the hot jobs employment report, the sentiment in the market got a reality check. We're now waiting for the CPI. If the CPI comes out too hot, defying expectations, then you will see a complete abandonment of the tech, cyclicals, software, and chips trade. You will see more money flowing into energy, materials, and most importantly, the defensives, utilities and REITs, the big pharma names. However, if the cooks at the bureau give us a cool number in the CPI, even cooler than expectations, you will see the opposite of this heat map happening tomorrow. You will see dumping of utilities, of REITs, of the inflationary stocks, and moving back into software, chips, reopening names, cyclicals, and technology stocks. The big caps will catch a bit. And speaking of the big caps, what about Google? Alphabet, the big Goog, which we love and adore, of course, in this channel, since I work for them. Well, we have the DOJ, the Department of Justice, coming after Google for monopoly practices in advertising. Apparently, the Department of Justice woke up from the coma. We'll see how long that would last. And then we have NVIDIA, the CEO, promises that no layoffs will happen. Even though we told the revenues will go down big, we're not laying off any employees, nothing to see here, please disperse. And of course, here's the headline from the future. NVIDIA lays off 2% of its workforce. Da-da-da. Moving on to the heat map for the ETFs, what do we see here? Mostly negative activities, profit taking from the recent winners, the XBI, the XRT, the XHB for home builders. They're taking profits across the board. Even the SMH, by the way, chips, they were recent winners until this week. What are they buying instead? They're buying the recent losers. We're talking about energy, the XOP, XLE, OIH. We're talking about utilities, the XLU, materials, the XME, REITs, IYR. All of these are catching a bit right now. And we see value outperforming growth by a little bit, even though both closed in the red. When we talk about commodities, muted action across the board with exception of the UNG for natural gas and the BOIL, the leverage index of the UNG, all in the green because of natural gas prices moving higher today. The VIX proxies, UVXY, slightly higher. My hunch is that will move a lot higher after the CPI. And it is muted across the board, the calm before the storm in international ETFs, no major movements at all. So let's move on to charts, and I have a lot of bonus charts for you, by the way, by the end. But let's start with SPY, the S&P 500 30 minutes chart. What do we see here? We got the bear flag yesterday. It got us a drop down, but the trading remains within range. The support 410, resistance at around 416. Nothing major will happen until one of these two lines is broken. 410 means a shorting opportunity all the way to at least 405, a break above 416. Higher we go. When we look at the MACD indicator, from a 30 minutes perspective at least, it is getting really oversold. Now, usually, assume that the CPI is out of the picture. We don't have a CPI tomorrow. When I see a chart like this, with the MACD being really, really oversold, and we have bearishness in the options market of buying the leverage indices, for example, I usually say we might see a gap and crap phenomenon, meaning the SPY pops higher, we see a gap higher in the morning, and then the sell-off comes right away, and the chart loses 410 once and for all. But we do have the CPI, and that can change things. The technicals could not matter at all. If the CPI comes out hotter than expectations, we will see a gap down right away, regardless of the oversold conditions of the MACD indicator. Now, if we get a cooler than expectations reading, specifically in the core CPI, we will see a gap higher. That could take us above 416 right off the gate. So buckle up your seatbelts. But from a daily chart perspective on the futures for the SPY, this is a bull flag consolidation. The support 4100, the resistance 4200. But the momentum indicators are getting really, really overextended, meaning there is a risk to the downside. If the CPI comes out disappointing, indicating the Fed has to tighten more, you will see a flush down, and the chart is going to lose the support of 4100 right off the gate. So we have the battle of the technicals, even though the technicals are not all favoring the bulls, by the way. The candlestick pattern favors the bulls. The volume favors the bulls, but the momentum indicators, not so much. The momentum indicators appear to be topping. Now, the CPI, it is what it is. What about the Qs? 30-minute chart for the NASDAQ. What's going on here? We got the bear flag. That played out, and it got us all the way down to the support at around 316, forming yet another bear flag. Is that going to play out right off the gate? Sure. If we have a hotter than expectation CPI, we will see the gap down right off the gate. And then we have 313 to look down for. Now, what if we have a gap higher, supported by the CPI and supported by the oversold conditions of the MACD indicator? Then the bear flag might play out, but it could play out later on. Meaning, we could see a gap higher that could get us all the way to fill the gap that the chart opened from today's activities. Then it gets rejected from that point on. The watch out, we could see a lot of pies being served here, because we could get a gap higher because somebody interpreted something about the CPI. The chart goes higher, fills the gap, and then we see the sellers showing up and flushing the chart once and for all to lose 316 of support. Now, is that scenario likely? Not really, because the CPI will seal the deal right in the morning before trading even starts. The unlikely scenario is actually opening flat, because the assumption for now, we're going to get a gap. Is it going to be a gap higher or a gap down? That's the question. So the element of surprise is actually a muted reaction by the charts. Now, here's where it gets troublesome for the bulls. The daily chart for the continuous contract for the NASDAQ. Yes, it is a bull flag consolidation, or you could look at it as a beginning of an ABC pattern. The bulls would say, we got the A leg. Couldn't make it above the resistance at around 13,300. So the chart is taking a leg down, forming the B leg. And then after the CPI, we'll get the pop higher all the way to the trend line in yellow, around 14,000. The bears are going to counter and say, watch out here, because yes, the volume is down right now. The candlestick pattern is forming a bull flag. But remember, you guys, meaning the bulls, went ahead of yourself by assuming that the Fed is going to pivot. When the CPI comes out, showing you that the Fed is not going to pivot, we're going to see these momentum indicators that are rolling off right now that became way overextended playing out. We will see a flush down that will take us below 12,766. So the bull flag, the ABC pattern, all of that gets out of the window. And then the next support would be at around 12,207. And that could coincide with the trend line, as you can see in yellow. If the chart stops there, then the pattern of higher lows is still intact. But if the chart breaches below that, then watch out, the pattern of higher lows is over. And now we're going to talk about retesting the June bottom. Here's the IWM, the Russell 2000, 30-minute chart. What's going on here? We got the bear flag from yesterday that got us below 191.5. We're now back in range, support 188, resistance 191.5. Now, psychologically speaking, why would the chart lose an important support of 191.5 when it already beaten that resistance and made it into support? It gapped above it. The assumption here is it should have at least kept that support intact. The fact that the chart lost that support in an aggressive fashion tells us that the chart is not ready to trade above 191.5. And in fact, the next move will be to the downside. This is the psychology of the charts. The CPI will do whatever the CPI does to these charts, but reading the psychology, it says the chart doesn't have the energy to move higher anymore, and therefore the sellers should show up and push the chart down. And if that is the case, we have 188 as support, and after that, we could see a flush down all the way to the next support, which will be at around 185. Next, the Dixie, the dollar index, what's going on here? Now, here's a practice for you. Assume that I removed the labels from this chart, you don't know what it is, and I removed the context. CPI, there's no CPI. Forget about it. Just look at the chart, technically speaking. Look at the MACD, look at the RSI, and fill in the blank. Do you think the MACD will go lower from this point on? When we see these red impressions in the histogram becoming shorter and shorter and shorter, when we see the RSI appearing to be bottoming and moving its way higher, where do you think this chart will go? Technically speaking, the answer is higher. Now, let's bring back the context in the picture and tie it in. Why would the dollar move higher? The answer is a hotter than expectation CPI, or at least a CPI that says the Fed is not done here. More tightening is coming. More tightening means higher US dollar. Higher US dollar means lower NASDAQ. See, this is what we do in this channel, being an investigator, piecing the pieces of the puzzle every single day, and let the chips fall whatever they may. Nobody knows for sure if a chart's going to move up or down day to day, but our job is to bring all of the pieces of the evidence that we get every single day and stitch them together and come up with a conclusion, a rational conclusion based on the facts. Here is gold. What's going on here? A daily chart. Yes, it is running higher, but I'm not going to be comfortable to say that gold is out of the woods without knowing for sure that the dollar is done moving higher. For now, we don't have that sense of security that the dollar is done moving higher, and therefore all of this rally could frizzle out and be erased immediately. The moment the dollar moves higher, gold will move down. What about Brent oil? 4 hours chart, what's going on here? It is stalling. The good news is it is above the critical support of around 94.47, but oil bulls are not going to feel better until it catches another support line, in this case 99. Better yet, retesting that support line and confirming that 99 is support for now, that the sell-off in oil is over. For now, can you feel any sense of security at all in buying the dip in oil futures when it is below 99? Not me. The 10-year yield, consolidating for now, the calm before the storm. Yet when we look at the momentum indicators, the RSI and the MACD, again, fill in the blank. Remove the context from the picture. Forget that this is the chart of the 10-year yield. This is just a regular random chart. You look at the MACD, the RSI, the conclusion is higher we go. I cannot guarantee that this will happen, but the technicals say higher we go. Now, what merits a pop in the 10-year yield? The answer is a hotter than expectation CPI. Means the Fed has to be more aggressive with tightening the policy and increase interest rates even further. But here's the problem. Pay attention now. The psychology says if the Fed tightens more, if it increases interest rates by 75 basis points in September, maybe an emergency meeting in August, or going as far as 100 basis points, that increases the probability of a recession, which should push the 10-year down, not up. However, if the CPI shows that the Fed doesn't need to tighten the monetary policy further, maybe they need to go milder, 50 basis points, 25 basis points, then growth expectations in the economy will move higher, and therefore the 10-year will move higher. This is the dilemma, folks. This is the problem that we have in the bond market. The 10-year moves higher for two reasons. The good reason is higher growth expectations. The bad reason would be higher interest rate hikes expectations. The 10-year could move down for the good reasons, meaning inflation expectations are going down and the Fed doesn't need to increase interest rates further. But it could also go down for the bad reason, which is a recession, which means the Fed down the line will have to cut interest rates. I hope this is clear, because anybody who says with certainty that the 10-year yield will pop or go down in reaction to the CPI, they have no clue. Nobody has a clue right now what the 10-year will do. We can read the psychology, we can have the probabilities, but we cannot say for certain how the 10-year is going to react, because there are two possibilities for each outcome in the CPI. Likewise, the TLT, flattish, no major move at all within the same range from yesterday, but we're going to see a major move tomorrow in reaction to the CPI. Here's the VIX 4 hours chart. The MACD indicator says the VIX should go higher, meaning the SPY should go down. On top of that, the VIX recaptured 21.53 as support, so all of these are indicators that the VIX should move higher and SPY should move down. But here's the problem, the CPI. The CPI could change everything, yet the technicals say higher VIX, lower SPY. What about the VXN, the VIX for the NASDAQ? Again, it continues to hold on the critical support of 27.5, retesting that support over and over and over and over again. We look at the MACD indicator. So far, it has been a battle with no clarity at all. We're not seeing a divergence, a meaningful one, from the average. You see the white line, that's the MACD, the average in blue. We did not see decisive readings in the histogram one way or the other, and therefore the uncertainty. But now it appears that the MACD indicator is diverging higher. We see the green impressions of the histogram getting slightly larger, indicating that we have positive momentum for the VXN. And if that plays out, then the Qs will go down. But once again, I hate to bore you, the CPI is in charge here. The technicals will come last. What about Apple? The big kahuna, what's going on here? A daily chart. No update here, within range, but we're starting to see the momentum indicators, the RSI and the MACD rolling over, indicating that Apple should go down. Furthermore, when we zoom in to an hourly chart, what does this look like? It looks like a bear flag consolidation. I cannot guarantee what the CPI is going to do, but the technicals say Apple should go down. And if Apple goes down, so will the NASDAQ. Tesla, 30 minutes chart, what's going on here? Now we have an explanation on why Tesla shares dumped as of late. The explanation is, well, Reverend Elon Musk was dumping big time. Da-da-da-da. You see, you geniuses, the culties and the meme stock, apes or whatever, you chase these hypes. What happens? In the weaker stocks, the Coinbases of the world, the Carnival Cruises, the AMCs, the Bed Bath & Beyonds, every time these stocks pop higher, they're going to dump on your little head. Why? Because they need to raise cash. The balance sheets are absolutely awful. they will take the advantage of any pump to raise cash. Now, in a hypermania stock such as Tesla, Reverend Elon knows that the stock is way overvalued. He knows the stock is going to crash. So the con man will get any opportunity when he sees the stock moving higher in an impulsive fashion to take the advantage and dump on your little head too. And he needs billions and billions of dollars. This lawsuit with Twitter could cost him billions and billions of dollars. So we have a ceiling here, folks, in these stocks. When it comes to Tesla, every time the stock goes higher, Reverend Elon will dump in your head. With the weaker stocks, every time these stocks go higher, they're going to move down again because management will raise cash by dumping more shares. So stick to high-quality stocks. Stick to reasonable stocks that are not in the hypermania category, that are not in the weaker balance sheet category, and you'll be fine. Now, technically speaking, what do we see here? The chart lost 886's support due to the dumping by the Rev. It lost 866's support, and now we have a downward sloping line of resistance. Can the chart break above that? It is possible, because if you zoom in to a 5 minutes chart or a 3 minutes chart, you will see a pattern of a higher low. Number one. Number two, it is getting oversold even in the 30 minutes perspective, so we could see a pop, but who's to say we're not going to see more selling by the Rev and the chart fails at the resistance at around 866. Think about the psychology too. Even the culties who bought Tesla recently, when they hear Elon Musk dumping, why is he dumping? We know about his legal problems, but he also sees what's going on with the economy and what's going on with valuations. Maybe he's seeing slower demand in the horizon and he knows the stock will go down. All of that's going to play out, and you will see loss of confidence in the chart. So regardless if we have a crossing above the sloping line of resistance, I see sooner or later this chart is going to move down below 800. That support will be lost. And then we're going to talk about 700 once again. And here's Bitcoin, 2 hours chart. What's going on here? We talked about the bull flag from yesterday. And I said if that melts down, then we don't have risk on in the stock market. We have risk off. And Bitcoin indeed melted down and went back into the consolidation range. Now, we have covered numerous charts in this program when we see this similar pattern. A consolidation pattern, a consolidation range, excuse me. And then we see a break above this consolidation range, only to fail in the chart to go down back into the consolidation range. An example, Netflix, the daily chart. Another example, Amazon, a daily chart. What happens next is we see the real break of the consolidation range. And the real break happens to the downside. Now, this is a 2 hours chart. It's not as significant as the daily chart, but all charts act and react the same way. So if this assumption holds, the real break in Bitcoin should be to the downside. And then we're going to talk about revisiting 22,000 as support. Now, here are some bonus charts for you. And these charts are at the highest risk of being sold off if we have a negative reaction to the CPI. Why? Because they ran too high in a short amount of time. They're becoming overbought, quote unquote. So I want you to be laser focused on the RSI, because if the sentiment change due to the CPI and we see dumping in the stock market, these are the names that are going to suffer the most. Why? Because we're going to see a lot of profit taking in these names. The first chart is the ticker ADSK Autodesk. A massive run since the July bottom, from around 170 all the way to above 200. The chart is now trading at around 220. But look at the RSI. Way overextended. If we have a dump in the stock market, we will see a big sell-off in this stock. Another one. The ticker DKNG, DraftKings. A massive run since the July bottom, from around $11 a share all the way to about 20. The chart almost doubled in price, but the RSI is way overbought. If we have a dump, DraftKings will sell off significantly, and therefore I have puts in this name. Another one, the ticker ETSY, Etsy. A massive run since the June bottom this time around, but it's overdone now. Look at the RSI, way overbought. If we have a downturn, this is going to be one of the tickers that will suffer the most. Another one, the ticker F for Ford. Since July, the chart moved from around $11 a share to about $16 a share. Way overbought, at the risk of pulling back if we have a downturn in the market. Another one, the ticker FCEL, Fuel Cell, ran way too high in a short amount of time, and it became way overbought in the RSI. If the stock market goes down, we have a sell-off, this name will suffer tremendously. Another one, the ticker LYFT for Lyft, massive run higher recently, but if we have a sell-off, this is going to sell off big time because the RSI is way overbought. Lots of profit-taking will happen. Likewise, the ticker MMM, for 3M. Nice run as of late, but it's overdone. Way overbought in the RSI and the MACD. Again, if we have a downturn in the stock market, MMM will go down by a lot. We have a lot of gaps, by the way. Notice all these gaps. A lot of these gaps will be filled. Another one, the ticker NET, Cloudflare. Massive run after earnings, but it is getting overdone here in the RSI. If we have a pullback, this chart will go down big. It could close the gap even, so watch out for this one. Then we have another one, the ticker PCTY for Paylocity. Ran way too high after earnings, massive gains, but it's overdone. High risk of pulling back in this chart. Another one, the ticker PYPL, PayPal. A nice run since July from around 70 all the way to 100. It is due for a pullback, and this pullback could be severe because the name is overbought. We could go down all the way till filling the gap. Another one, the ticker RBLX, Roblox. Massive rally since the July bottom. The stock almost doubled in price. And therefore, when I saw the catalyst, which happened to be earnings, it is pretty much impossible for the stock to live up to the expectations from earnings. You have a 90% plus gains running into earnings. The risk becomes to the downside. Big time. So to me, this was an easy trade. Thank you so much. Buying puts, easy money. Next, we have UBER, the ticker for Uber. Also ran way too high after earnings. Massive pop, lots of short covering. But guess what happens after short covering? When the charts become way overbought, we see profit taking from the buyers this time around, the dip buyers. We see perhaps the shorts coming back in the picture. Here's another one, the ticker WING, Wingstop. Massive run since the May bottom this time around. The chart almost doubled in price, went from around $70 a share to $140 a share. Too much in a short amount of time. The chart is way overbought at the risk of pulling back. And here's the last one I got for you, the ticker WM, Waste Management, a stock that I used to own last year. It ran way too high in a short amount of time. It is at the resistance of the double top, the MACD, the RSI, way overbought, overextended. It is at a risk of a massive flush down if we have a sell-off in the stock market. You can do the same exercise. Look at the charts that you have in your program. Look at these charts that ran way too high in a short amount of time. Look at the RSI, the MACD. If the chart is way overextended, it is due for a pullback, and perhaps the CPI will be the catalyst to initiate a sell-off in the stock market and a pullback in these charts. Lastly, moving on to the conclusion of this video, what do we have on the economic calendar tomorrow? In case you were asleep throughout the video. Most importantly, we have the CPI, the Consumer Price Index, but we also have some Fed zombies speaking, so we're going to know the reaction of the Fed immediately to the CPI. We have Fed zombie from Chicago, Evans, and then we have the demon from Minneapolis, Neil Kashkari. Two doves, so the bulls might feel a little hopeful here. But anyhow, lots of action is due tomorrow, so buckle up your seat belts, grab your popcorn, but this is all I got for you for now. Thank you for listening. Thank you for watching. I will talk to you again tomorrow.